Welcome to South Asia Maps, the educational channel for the intellectual Kshatriyas, where your articulate presenter J. Reddy as a facilitator will bring you the geography, history, culture, heritage of South Asia and its ancient civilization south of Karakoram Mountains and north of Kanyakumari. I appreciate all the viewers for subscribing and encouraging our channel. In this presentation today, we will be discussing about imperialisms, the language of Christian imperialism, and these languages, this idea of delineating a imperialistic languages with four imperialisms all shared the common eight features was done by India's Rishi of Resurgent India, one of a great thinker of modern times called Acharya Sitaram Goyalji, and Mahayogi Sri Ram Swarup, who passed away round about 2000. They are considered to be the great thinkers of modern India, or Hindu Renaissance and Hindu Awakening are the Trimurti in the forefront. The today's presentations has taken especially from the works of intellectual Kshatriya of modern times, Sitaram Goyalji, or Rajarshi Sitaram Goyalji, is the perversion of political parlance in India. That is the book published by the Voice of India. Excuse me. Sitaram Goyalji delineates eight characters of imperialism. Imperialism is a dominating idea where a particular section or a group from one part of the world dominates the rules other sections of the planet Earth. Most of the time in the political histories, we are aware of Western imperialism or colonialism, but Ram Swarup Ji and Sitaram Goyal Ji delineate four types. All the four types he has mapped to eight characters. The character that the language features they speak are very common. This is a very fascinating, the intellectual concept he has developed. The nine or eight characters of the language spoken by these imperialisms are inscrutable entity, incomparable person, human history divided into two parts, mankind is divided into two parts, and human, the land where humans inhabit, the planet Earth itself is divided into two parts. So the language of these four imperialisms sees three clear-cut definitions and bands together certain sections as a group and puts them against non-other sections. The entire whole earth is mandated for them, and it sees two inevitabilities, and it has a very high sense of self-righteousness, smugness, a coziness, superiority complex, and all it does this accusing the other societies and people of certain crimes. These crimes are imaginary in their language features. Today we'll discuss those nine language features with European imperialism. In the last two presentations, I discussed about Islamic imperialism, its language features, and Christian imperialism, its language features, and a third presentation under the banner of imperialisms, comparing Islamic imperialism with the Christian imperialism. Most of the Westerners think they are different, but Sitaram Goyal ji says they are one and the same, and we saw the commonalities and had that video in the playlist, and you can go and look at that video. Excuse me. Today we look at the European imperialism. In India, it is essentially a British imperialism. From the book, it says it came as the language of British imperialism. It shared common features with the French imperialism, Dutch imperialism, Portuguese imperialism, and Belgian and Italian and German and Russian imperialism. These all imperialisms which emanated from Europe enslaved vast sections of the people from two Americas and enslaved the people of Africa and enslaved the people of Asia with the force of superior arms. This, the language of European imperialism, is essentially a language of Christian imperialism, which we look at later when comparing all these four imperialism in one slide or presentation. That is the language of Christian imperialism, language of Islamic imperialism, the language of European imperialism, and language of communist imperialism. It is, suffice here to say, essentially the language of European imperialism is the world language of the Christian imperialism. But it was dressed up in the secular verbiage, in the secular lingo, in the secular language. It tenets are essentially these things. And we look at these tenets, nine tenets of Euro language of European imperialism. It brought a great havoc in course of 150 years after British won the Carnatic Wars in 1750, and in 1757 they won Battle of Plassey in Nadia and Murshidabad district border on the east side of River Bhagirathi or Hooghly, and established very firmly the European imperialism on Indian soil. From 1752, almost, that means 1800, 200 years, it brought large-scale destruction to Indian society. British deported in middle of the 20th century in 1947, but the language of British imperialism survived in India intact in the ruling classes of the present day in India. As one of the India's eminent thinker, Arun Shauri ji, says, alien rule after 1947, partition independence of India, was replaced by the rule by the alienated. Alien's rule replaced by the rule by the alienated. Why this happened is due to Macaulayism, which is the child of British imperialism or European imperialism. Its remnant, European imperialism, on the Indian soil left a residue, a remnant. That remnant is Macaulayism. We will look at it at certain time later. Essentially, the language of European imperialism looks to the West for ideological inspiration as a concrete social, political, military, economic models in all the matters of the major importance. In that sense, it has reduced, as Sitaram Goyal says, Indian elite and Indian leaders are intellectual compradors sporting the brown skin like the apes of the West, a replicas. And the Indian people as a pack of handicapped children ruled by these brown sahibs, as it is called generally. So let us look at the language. Here I have put the icon, so this represents Union Jack, represents the British imperialism on the Indian soil or South Asia. And a Portuguese imperialism in Goa also I have posted, because this is also very powerful imperialism in the Indian soil. Even though Portuguese failed to gain a lot of territory, but they were the first to establish on the Indian soil 150 years prior to the British won the Battle of Palasi. So, as usual, the language of imperialisms has 7, 8, or 9 characters. There is an inscrutable entity in every language. In case of European imperialism, this inscrutable entity is the Western civilization. In case of Islam, we saw this inscrutable entity that nobody saw is Allah. In case of Christian imperialism, that inscrutable entity is Yahweh. Here, this inscrutable entity is a broad Western civilization. You cannot scrutinize it. And there is incomparable person. In case of Islamic imperialism, that incomparable person is Muhammad, born in Mecca in 572 AD and died in 632. And in case of European imperial, in case of Christian imperialism, that inscrutable person is the Jesus Christ, son of the Yahweh itself. In the case of European imperialism, that inscrutable person, or sorry, that incomparable person is white man. He's very incomparable. That means whatever he does and says are incomparable. Everybody has to follow it. So we have inscrutable entity, their civilization itself, that the civilization that was developed in Europe. At that time, the contemporary Chinese civilization are the Indic civilizations. They are very powerful and very prosperous and are also very wealthy also. Europe at that time was not at all. But because this imperialism originated in the European soil and developed by the Europeans, Western civilization is given an inscrutable entity, and the white men who inhabit Europe are given an incomparable person. I have to make a note here, a criticism of the language of European imperialism is not at all any racial or ethnic or criticizing the people who are born in Europe. It is nothing like that. This is an intellectual exploration of imperialism and its language feature that the audience has to keep in mind, not preaching any hatred or enmity to any section of the society. As Sitaram Goyal says, so the humanity is divided into two parts, human history. The part before the 16th century, that means the beginning of 1500, where most of these explorations, the discovery of the trade routes, the sea lanes to America and Europe has, Americas and Asia and India has happened. The history before 16th century, the beginning the 1500, and afterwards, that means there are two parts of the human history. The mankind is divided into two sections, a civilized European section, European people, and savage Native Americans, savage tribes, of course Africans, and savage Asians. The mankind is divided into two parts. Like Islamic imperialism divides into kafirs and divides into believers, mu'mins, Muslims, and Christian imperialism divides into Christians, that is believers, and infidels, Gentiles, and heathens. European imperialism divides into savage Asians, Africans, and Native Americans, and civilized Europeans. Of course, here he has not mentioned the land is divided into civilized European world and savage the rest of the American, Asian and African world. American world in the sense before the explorers like Columbus and all those people landed there, before that is a savaged world and civilized European world. So it sees the three clear-cut divisions of the humanity into civilized Europeans, non-civilized rest, and land into civilized nation and savaged nations, and human history at the bright period and a darker period. Before the Europeans discovered everything is dark, after they discovered these lands, they brought the light, the European civilization. So that is very clear, three clear cut divisions of the humans and the land inhabited by humans and the human history, the spatio-temporal denouement of human civilizations. And it bans all these Europeans, like so many Iberic people and Scandinavic and Slavic people and Roman people and Greeks, as a one supreme nation, forgetting about their cultural, ethnic and local historical differences. It bans all of these people at a white man or white race dominating the world. And it mandates, this is the mandate, not mandate, it's a mandate type of his. It mandates the whole world, the language of European imperialism, language the whole world to the white man, his legatee, the white man, the legatees of European civilization, the white man, and enjoins on them, here in case of India, is a British. In certain other parts, maybe the French or Russians, etc. And he takes the civilizing mission of civilizing savage tribes in Asia and Africa. It's called, piously, a white man's burden. As a white man has carrying lot of burden in bringing the civilization to these savage people of Africa and Asia and pre-Columbian America. And it sees two inevitabilities. The language of European imperialism sees two inevitabilities. That is the triumph of Western civilization. That is the triumph of European civilization, where the savage or native tribal civilizations of Africa, Asia, and North America, Central America, Latin America, South America. It sees these two inevitabilities, the triumph of European civilization and collapse and defeat, subjugation of savage civilizations, African civilization and Asian civilization, and so on. It has very high degree of self-righteousness, a smugness, a superiority complex in their lingo, in their behavior, in their mannerism, a sanctimony. That means the customs, the social orders, the social values, the sexual mores, and their food habits, dietary habits, their civilization, everything is superior, and the inferior, the native civilizations, their social systems and their sexual mores and their dietary habits, their linguistic features, their culture, their mode of worship, everything has to be replaced by the European civilization. In India it has to be replaced by the British civilization, which are the representatives of European imperialism or legatees of doing that white man's burden, shouldering that responsibility in the South Asian soil. And this language of European imperialism accuses, why are you doing all this? Means you have to point something to you. There should be a casus belli to go to a war, between any nations. That means you have to accuse them. This language accuses Hindus, say they are living in superstition. You are living in a barbaric society. You have infanticide, you have sati, the burning of your ladies, you have child marriages. All these crimes are thrown at these ancient nations, Chinese, Indic, and African nations, Americans were accused living in superstition. And so these people are trying to help as the language, lingo, self-righteousness goes to bring the light to the savaged societies of Asia and Africa. So we will see the European settlements, the dawn of European colonialism in India. First Europeans who land in India are Portuguese navigators, explorers, pirates, plus priests, everything dressed up as one, Sitaram Goyalji tells. But they were mostly marketed throughout the world because the Europeans wrote these histories, and there intellectual compradors in India, the brown sahibs, followed it lock, stock and barrel. They are called explorers, and we can keep the title for discussion, nothing wrong, but that aspect also has to be brought to the attention of the audience. Portuguese are essentially the pirates, came to this Bartolomeo first rounded up Cape, that is the in the Union of South Africa, and later 1498, nearly 1500, Vasco da Gama, the Portuguese pirate, landed in the Malabar region, that is the Calicut region or Kozhikode region, ruled by Samuthris or the Jamorin rulers, and they waged a lot of pirating and attacking the people and converting them. Here, that means their European settlement until 1739, just before the few years before the Carnatic Wars broke in India, where European imperialism saw a great opportunity to intervene in the local affairs. We see the island of Goa here, Diu, and the Surat, the British established their post in 1612, and Daman and Bassein, the British, Portuguese had there the trading post and military establishment, Bassein or Wassein, north of Bombay, also called Bakain, and the island of Bombay and Salset Island, and of course Portuguese captured the Gomantak, the island Velhe Goa, the island of Goa, from the local Islamic imperialist Adil Shahi rulers of Bijapur. From Yusuf Adil Shah, they captured Goa in 1510. Of course, they tried to establish their military establishment at Kannur, south of Mangalore or north of Calicut, and French has their establishment in Mahe near Kannur, and British has in Telicherry, the next to that, and in Calicut, in Cochin. Dutch has a great influence, and the ruler of Cochin, who was the major antagonist of Jamorin in the north, and of course they have establishment in Colombo and Galle in the Sri Lankan island Matara, Trincomalee, Jaffna, on the east coast of India called Cholamandal coast or Coromandal coast or coastal region, at Nagapattinam in Thanjavur Delta and Karaikal in Thanjavur Delta, in Puducherry at the mouth of Palar River near Kadalur in the Arcot region, and Sadras few kilometers north of it, and of course the Madras was the major center of Madras Presidency, where the British propelled themselves as a major military power in the Indian soil after the Three Carnatic War. That region is called Carnatic region. It's not Karnataka, that is a Mysore state with the Bangalore capital. Carnatic region means essentially the Nellore district and two Arcot districts, and South Arcot, North Arcot, and Tiruchirappalli, and Thanjavur district, and Madurai, and Marwar territory, Ramanathapuram, and Tirunelveli, and Machilipatnam, also called Bandar, and Yanam, in the mouth of Godavari River, French established their colony, and Vizagar, Visakhapatnam, of course in Calcutta, British has their military post and trading center in Serampore and so on. These are the various European settlements that were the centers of this language of European imperialism. And the work has been, I have taken this work for the presentation from Voice of India books. Voice of India is an intellectual think tank established by Mahayogi Sri Ramaswarup Ji, who is India's considered to be the greatest thinker in the latter part of the 20th century. That means after partition 1947 until his death 1998, nearly 50 years. And they have developed a doctrinal work, first time giving a native reply to British imperialism, Christian imperialism, and Islamic imperialism, and communist imperialism. You can go to this book, and I have put the link also in the description in the bottom. You can Google Voice of India books and go to this Voice of India books big bucket and so. I have taken these points from the perversion of political parlance, and you can see there are a lot of verse written by Sitaram Goyalji, Ramaswarup, and Coenrod Elst. You can see the lot of their scholarly works, and this is one of the great book. Sitaram Goyalji is earned his renowned status as a great thinker and got a lot of admirers, and the characters of the leftist language. Previously, what are these imperial characteristics? We have delineated nearly 9, and 7th, 8th, and 9th. And I discussed extensively the language of imperialism, those language features mapped to those 8 characters. I also discussed language of Christian imperialism, mapping to that part. And today we discussed Western imperialism or European imperialism. And I have taken from this part, from this book. So, essentially today, we discussed about the imperialism, the third imperialism, the language of European imperialism in India, which was established in the middle of in the beginning of 1500, that is 16th century, and we saw the 9 character features of the all the imperialism. In case of British imperialism, the inscrutable entity is the Western civilization, that is European civilization. Incomparable person is the white man. Human history divided into the dark period and light period after the dawn of the Europeans and the various parts of the world, Asia and Africa and Americas. The mankind is divided into civilized Europeans and barbaric savaged Asians and Africans. The land is divided into the barbaric land and the civilized land. And all the people in Europe are banded together like a sterile monolithic one person, forgetting, superseding all their wars, behaviors, cultural, historic heritages. For this, the for this imperialistic purpose, like all the Christian proselytes throughout the world is banded like a Christians and put against to fight the Gentiles or heathens in case of Christian imperialism, and all the converts, Muslim converts like Asia and Africa, the Arabs, the Kurds, the Turks, and Berbers, Pashtuns, Bengalis, and Moro Muslims of Philippines, everybody banded together is a sterile Muslim and Ummah, and hurled against the feels like that. Here it bans them like single monolithic white race dominating the world. And this imperialism, as usual, it sees the white man's burden of civilizing the barbaric nations, and he sees the two inevitabilities, the triumph of this civilization and the collapse or defeat of the barbaric savage types are superseding them. And it also has a degree of self-righteousness, superiority, smugness, sanctimony, and talking about their social customs, order, civilization, and putting down the native civilizations, even though there are much ancient native civilizations existed on the planet Earth, like Indian civilization, Vedic and Buddhist, and Southeast Asian and Chinese civilizations, and accuses all these people of the crimes of superstition and all those barbaric things, even though such things existed in every civilization. But these are the targeted, and they are called superstitious people and need to be replaced by the European civilization. Very high-flowing lingo. So that is in essence about the characteristic features of the language of European imperialism we discussed today. This is your presenter JRD. Please subscribe and encourage our educational channel, which is targeting the intellectual Kshatriyas for building the intellectual equipage and giving the knowledge of this ancient civilization south of Karakoram Mountains and north of Kanyakumari in the South Asian region in the form of maps, icons, images for your articulation. Thank you very much and see you later.